Please join me in our call to worship. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. Our God shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. Let the people say, "We praise you, mighty God." The voice of our God causes the oaks to whirl and strips the forests bare. And in God's temple, all say glory. Let the people say, "We praise you, mighty God." The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. Our God sits enthroned as ruler forever. Let the people say, "We praise you, mighty God." May our God give strength to the people. May the Lord bless the people with peace. Let the people say, "We praise you, mighty God."
Let us pray. God, we seek your presence today because in relationship with you, we know who we are. You are the ground of our being, our meaning and purpose and joy. You crafted our skills and gifted us with talents and interests. You call us to be your church, and you empower us with your spirit and your word. We are your people, God. Let us feel your presence as we worship you today and travel with us through this week, always reminding us who we are and whose we are. In Christ's name we pray, amen.
How many of us can look back and remember defining moments? This week, I needed a reality check, a literal check that where I am is real. I kept looking around my house to steady myself. I realized that for many months I have been doing this, looking for a reality that seems safe and familiar. Maybe the word is more than reality. Maybe the word is grounding. Once I feel grounded, those words I talked about a couple of months ago kept coming to light. Connection, change, and strength. When there is that moment of clarity, or do I say epiphany? It can be a defining moment if we want to embrace it. It can be beautiful and scary. But defining moments are a shift in our reality. It can ground us back to where we need to be or shift us in a direction we're now supposed to take. These moments can be new beginnings, which is never negative, just unknown. A reboot in our lives that can enrich us. A reboot is looked forward to when we ring in the new year. It's expected. But a real change, a real reboot, a new beginning takes work and strength. For me, I am constantly wanting to get to the water. Being near the water, feet in the water, and just looking at the water is grounding. It magically helps clear my mind, if not only for a moment. The water is full of superpowers. It's mentioned in the Bible so many times. It's part of so many religious rituals. Water cleanses in a spiritual way and literally getting those germs off our hands. 70% of our brain is made of water. Water is full of superpowers that keep us going, growing, and calls us to renew. When Jesus was baptized in the river, was it the superpowers of the water that was a new beginning? Or was it that moment when coming out of the water when God spoke to him? You are my son, the beloved. With you, I am well pleased. The power of water can give us the nudge for a new beginning, but the power of words used kindly and lovingly can not only fill us with the power to move, but those words can be our superpower for the world. Have a great week.
And now together, let us say the prayer that Jesus taught us when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our lesson from the Hebrew Scriptures this morning comes from Genesis 1, verses 1 through 5. Listen to this beautiful story about the beginning of creation. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
But
Our gospel reading for this Sunday morning comes to us from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 4 through 11. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the Jordan River, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
I'm somebody that loves origin stories. Whether it's Star Wars and understanding where Luke Skywalker came from, or my beloved Lord of the Rings and the Fellowship beginnings in the Shire and understanding where Frodo came from. No matter what it is, whether it be in literature, art, there are stories that are central to us that all have origin components to them. And indeed, today we hear two of those origin stories through our lectionary reading. Sherry shared literally our very first origin story, the genesis of our sacred text, as she read the opening words of the first chapter of Genesis. And I shared the origin of Jesus' life as told through the Gospel of Mark. And what's interesting to consider about each of these stories is that each of them has variations in our own sacred text. Genesis 1, the creation story where God said, "Let there be light," and then takes 6 days to create all things, including ourselves, and we are created last on day 6, before God takes a well-deserved break on day 7. Chapter 1 of Genesis is followed immediately by chapter 2, where there is another version of the creation story, one in which humankind is created first, not last. And Adam is first created alone and is discerned to be lonely and needs a partner, and so falls asleep, and God famously takes a rib and creates Eve, and then the rest of creation comes. Two stories, two origins, both different. And the same is true for Jesus. Jesus' origins in the Gospels of Mark and of John begin in his adulthood, when he seeks out John the Baptizer in the River Jordan and seeks his own baptism before he goes off and calls disciples of his own and begins a life of public ministry. In the Gospels of Matthew and Luke, Jesus' origins begin at his birth. And even those two stories are dissimilar, because in Matthew, we have the story that involves stars and wise men, and in Luke, we have the story that involves angels and shepherds. So origins are important. Sometimes they're different, and each of us has one. And even for our own selves, our sense of origin may be different. For some, our origins may be, "This is where and when I was born, and I've always been there. And my sense of self and my sense of home and my sense of place and my sense of origin begins there." For others, it may be later in life, and regardless of where and when you were born, you discern that your life really began when you met
your spouse, you had your children, you began a certain job that set the trajectory of your life forever on a certain path, you moved to a certain place that became home for you for the first time, and life really began when? Origins are important. They put our life in a context, because none of us exists in a bubble or in a vacuum, and whoever we ultimately become and what our lives will be always stem from what came before, our origins. We are, each of us, a multitude in that regard. And so today, as we hear some origin stories and we take some time perhaps to consider our own sense of personal origin, I can't help but reflect upon the origins of this week and what happened on Wednesday in Washington, D.C. There are two ways in which origin plays a role as I reflect on Wednesday that I invite you to share with me. One is, what were the origins that led to Wednesday? Because we need to grapple with them. We need to understand that just as much as none of us exists in a vacuum and out of context, Wednesday didn't either. There were things that led to Wednesday. There were origins that led to our own citizens, our own sisters and brothers, as Americans, violently and angrily storming the center of democracy in our own country, and it led to death. That didn't just happen on Wednesday. And if we are to learn from it and become better because of it, we have to understand the origins that led to that day. We will be doing ourselves and our children a profound disservice if we do not do that. Origins also can be the harbinger of the ending of something and the beginning of another. A new origin, a new genesis, a phoenix, if you will, rising out of the ashes of what came before to live into a new beginning. And I profoundly hope that we take lessons from Wednesday and deeper understanding and begin a new story, that we allow what is still unfolding around us about that day right now to become the pages of a new, better, more loving, more connected story. A beginning where we write pages of a new chapter that are filled with more compassion and more bridge building than bridge burning, of less vitriol and rancor and division between ourselves in the ways in which we articulate and communicate with one another, particularly on social media. Ways in which we embrace and find again those things that more deeply connect us and remember that they are and always have been things that are stronger than what set us apart from one another. To remember that what we do from this point forward not only will affect ourselves, our neighbors, our children, and grandchildren, but indeed will have a profound effect upon the world to which we are also connected. That world that looks to us as leaders, as helpers, as sources of wisdom and assistance in helping to rectify the world's needs and problems. whether that's climate change or war or poverty or injustice in all of its forms, that we are looked to as a place of wisdom and compassion and knowledge in how to solve those issues in partnership with others around the world toward a better and more loving place for everyone. Origins. We're living one right now. And as people of faith, just as Jesus today leaves that river and goes off and gathers people around him and begins to discern how for himself he is called to live a life of service for the sake of others and for the world, in this moment, as people of faith, as disciples, as the legacy of that life that we read about today, we are also called to discern how we will move forward from this moment and also live lives of service for the betterment of this world that is so hurting right now. Because on top of the events of Wednesday, we still have all of the issues and problems that we had before Wednesday. Issues of injustice, of social unrest, of this global pandemic that now has new strains that are evolving that are more contagious than what we've been dealing with till now. The stewardship of our planet and our resources. The profound issues of poverty and all of the systems in which it thrives and all of the suffering that stems from it. And what we're living through now. The world needs us to write new pages of a new story, a new origin from this that will set us upon a path of writing the pages of a new and better, more loving, more connected story for the sake of us all. Amen.
This is the time in our service when we lift up joys and concerns. And today we have two great joys. We wish happy birthday to Bill Maynard and Eleanor McKechnie. On the 5th of January, Bill celebrated his 97th birthday. And on the 8th, Eleanor celebrated her 102nd birthday. So happy birthday, Bill and Eleanor. We celebrate you. Our congregation and our nation have suffered greatly. This past week was quite difficult. The violence that we have seen over the past few months has been shocking and sobering. Really, all of 2020 has been quite difficult in many ways. So today, let us simply pray for God's presence as we make our way into a new year with hopes for kinder, better things. Let us pray after a moment of silence. God of all creation, you have given us countless gifts, many opportunities, and unspeakable joys. But in these frightening and challenging times, what we need more than anything is to know that you are with us. When we are anxious and discouraged, we want you close. When we are angry and greedy and judgmental, we need your healing love. When we're hurt, diminished by others, feeling utterly alone, we need your presence and your assurance. We run to you, God, for shelter, but you give us more. For you have made us in your image and filled us with your spirit. It is in our very being that you dwell. We are your temple, not made with hands. We are the body of Christ, your church. If every wall should crumble and every temple decay, We are your sacred dwelling place. You are nearer than our breathing, more a part of us than hands and feet. Ours are the eyes with which you look upon this world with compassion. We run to you for shelter, God. We long for your presence, but you long for us to understand and to become the very refuge that we seek. In these most difficult times, God, help us to understand the mystery of your presence and the power of your love, for only these can heal our world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Our call to invitation. Faithful God, bless us in our baptismal calling to live the ministry of showing hospitality to others. We offer the gifts that we have been given to be used not for conquest and dominance, but for use in liberating the poor and hurting people who pray for our liberation as well as their own. Receive and multiply our gifts for life-giving ministry. Amen. We want to thank you for your continued support of the church. You can make those donations and your gifts and tithes here on this page with the Donate Now button, or you can mail them to the church office. May God continue to bless you, keep you safe and healthy. Amen.
As we leave this time of worship together, we thank you, God, for blessing us with memories of Jesus' baptism and our own. Thank you for removing our reluctance, doubt, and fears, and replacing them with courage and commission. Let us go forth with your calling, your direction, and your blessing, today and all of our days yet to come. Amen.